Hi, everybody. My name is Bret White, and I guess I'm the moderator. I own the comic shop Heroes Haven in downtown Roseburg. So I've been doing that for 30 years. So I'm introducing these folks, and I guess I'll let them introduce themselves since they probably are better at their names than I am.
Hello, my name is Paul Guinan. I've been working in comics for a long time. I've worked for all the different companies. Did projects for Marvel, DC, Dark Horse, Image, IDW. And I took a break from comics to start doing a series of books. I did two books. One is called Boilerplate, and the other one's called Frank Reed, and I have them at my table. And they're sort of like comics, but they're more like picture books. But they still are high adventure stories and historical, historical adventure stories, kind of like Indiana Jones kind of stuff. And I work with these people. We all work in the same studio.
My name is Fred Chao, and I do a book called Johnny Hero, Half Asian All Hero, and it's this kid right here, and it's mostly, trying to keep my head above water in New York. Oh no, giant Godzilla comes along and wrecks my sushi shop. What am I going to do? And then I just recently put out a kid's book called Allison and Her Rainy Day Robot. I think that's it for the most part.
All right, well,
I've got nothing else to say. See you guys later.
Jesus, my friend. I'm Kat Farris. I have done artwork for the book series Emily and the Strangers for Dark Horse, and I also have a webcomic called The Last Diplomat. It's kind of a fantasy adventure comic available online. Yes, you have that first chapter there. I have all three of the printed chapters available at my table. I've been working in comics for maybe like the last 12 years, and I have the pleasure of working with these two crazy dudes, so.
I noticed that all of our work has a kind of whimsy to it, which is interesting. We like comics that are fun. We're not really super into the dark, gritty, angry, angsty comics. We don't really care for that. We think that's been done.
I do that at night.
That's right. Yeah, if you come into the studio after midnight, you better watch out. Fred's like lurking in the shadows.
Okay. Oh, that's right. I just want to mention we have a studio. What it is it's not like a business. What it is it's a bunch of artists that got together and rented a space in one of the buildings in downtown Portland. And at first, we just got together just because we didn't want to sit at home by ourselves working on our stuff. It's more fun to be with other people, and it sort of keeps you disciplined because you want to show off to other people that you're working and not just goofing off. So it's also a good discipline. And then sometimes, if I'm too busy to do this project, I can bring in Fred or Kat to help me out. Or if Kat has to pass on a gig, and you know she can say, "Hey, does somebody else want to do this instead?" So there's little opportunities like that that are an advantage to being in the studio. And then also, we can sometimes pool, like if we have some money left over from the rent or from stuff that we've sold through our studio shop, we can then buy things for the studio that we wouldn't be able to afford by ourselves. So like a scanner or a printer or some computer equipment like digital drawing tools and stuff like that that may be too expensive for one of us, and we can use the studios. So there's a lot of advantages to coming together as a group and pooling your resources.
So how did you guys get started in comics, or what was your first interesting thing you discovered and interested in this field?
Well, I was a huge comics fan as a kid, and when I was in middle school, I really wanted to do comics, but I couldn't imagine getting paid for it, so I decided that maybe it wasn't a good career option. But I ended up going to college for animation, and instead ended up doing comics anyway. I kind of ended up falling in with these guys and was like, well, I can draw, but I'm not getting any animation work. I don't know what to do. And they said, if you can draw, you can make comics, and we'll kind of show you how to do it. And I fell in love with making comics, so I've been doing that ever since.
I guess I've just always read a lot. I was telling him the first comic that I came across was at my dentist's office. I was like, I don't know, maybe 10 years old. And it was like Spider-Man, Power Man, and Storm versus Smokescreen, who was this villain who just wanted kids to smoke cigarettes. So, and he would like give kids cigarettes out on the street, and then so it was a very like stay away from cigarettes kids comics. But I was just so blown away by the form of like, oh, words with pictures, you know. And So I've always kind of read comics all my life, and I've drawn for fun, but never thought about doing comics. Love stories, went to college for writing, literature, and publishing. And then what kind of ended up happening was, at that time I had written like two screenplays, half a novel, and a bunch of short stories, moved to New York, my place got broken into, my laptop stolen, so I lost everything and was like, crap, I want to do another story, but I want to do one in a format that no one would ever want to steal. So I did my first comic on just comic book and submitted it. An indie publisher picked it up, and then the first comic was kind of nominated for a couple Eisner Awards, and I was like, oh, cool, this is a nice way to tell stories. And I've, you know, kind of been able to keep at it. I kind of do that and design work now, so I help do a lot of book design as well.
Yeah, a similar story where I just grew up as a little kid loving comics. And I remember one of the first things I would make as a kid is I would take a regular typing paper and fold it in half and put staples in it and start drawing my little sort of little comic books, which you can do to this day. I mean, I have a couple of those kinds of things, what I call my sort of FedEx Kinko's specials, where you just draw a little comic book and you staple it, and she does similar things like that, where you just make it at your crappy printing place, and then you can sell them online or whatever. So I used to do this as a little kid, but then I didn't think that I would be able to make a living at that. I didn't think that when I was a kid, comics weren't cool the way they are now. That kind of kicked in the 90s, you know, for comics mainstreaming and becoming a cool thing. So I grew up in a period where that just wasn't a thing that was a real job. It was kind of like, well, you know, some people do it. So I went to school. I was going to get into film or television production, or I was going to do storyboards for TV and movies, which is kind of like comics, but actually pays real money. So the storyboards, for people that don't know, are like you draw out these little panels, and then a filmmaker will use them to figure out where to put the camera and how to do the action in the movie. So sometimes if you pick up a book of like The Art of Star Wars or something, they'll include not just drawings of designs about the vehicles, but they'll sometimes have little panels about how the shots are supposed to look when they're shot with a camera. So I started doing that, and then there's a comic book company in Chicago that opened up, and I started doing some work for them. And it was the first comic book company to be successful that wasn't doing superhero comics, because I wasn't very good at all the drawing of the muscles and stuff like that. I like science fiction. I like people in spacesuits and spaceships. So I saw that there was possibility to draw comics other than superhero comics, and I started doing that, and I fell in love with the medium all over again, just like I was. So I loved it as a kid, thought I wasn't going to really do it, and then wound up back in it. And I love doing it.
Do you think Portland has quite the comic book culture? Do you think that has also helped you become more entrenched in what you're doing, with having a studio? Because there's a huge number of comic artists in the Portland area. Mm-hmm. And back in the day, I know it was one of the very first locations there was a distributor back in the 70s. Mm-hmm. So all those things have coalesced. And now, you were talking earlier that there was more comic creators in the Portland area than there is virtually anywhere else besides New York.
Right.
And therefore, as you guys formed your studio, I saw on your guys' website that you've had members come and go. I assume those people have left on to get bigger and better or just move on to other projects.
There's not much of a ladder run because we're pretty awesome.
Right. That's where I was heading with this. Is that, as your studio evolves, is there opportunities for people to engage with you guys? And is there new people coming into your company? And
sure. There's always. I mean, it's not overwhelming. I mean, it's slow. Right. You know, it's we have a, it's not like a vetting process per se, but we do sort of want to get to know the people. Mm-hmm. And so they'll come in as like a temporary member or a part-time member or something like that to get an idea of like how they fit with the studio scene. But by the time we set up the studio, everybody involved in the studio was already in comics.
Okay.
So it wasn't necessarily that the studio inspired at least the initial group. Mm-hmm. But then Baquette, as she just mentioned, came into the studio with aspirations other than just doing comics, you know, animation. So absolutely, in her case, the studio infected her
and turned her into a comic book person instead of an animation person.
It became a valuable resource. Infection sounds so dire.
No, I'm just being silly.